all right. Block diagram representation of control systems. This is visible to you?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Hello.
Okay, so good afternoon again. I am Dr. Kanade, and today we will see a new topic from our first unit, which is block diagram representation of control systems. Okay. Now, as I just said, this is part of our first unit, and we are going to represent the given systems. Welcome kit. And we are going to represent our physical systems basically in terms of in form of block diagram. And this is the one. This is one of the most common way of representing the control systems. Okay. This is the outline of our today's lecture. I will talk about the introduction, then the one of the most important concept, which is called the canonical form of a control system. We will see what exactly is it, and then we will see how can we reduce complicated block diagrams. Basically, all the complicated block diagrams can be converted into a simple baseline canonical form, and this is how to do that. This is that the concept, the procedure is called the reduction of complicated block diagrams or block diagram reduction. Okay, and then after that we will see some of the examples of block diagram reduction. Okay, so to begin with, a block diagram basically is a shorthand pictorial representation of the cause and effect relationship of a system, right? Cause and effect relationship means what, or a pictorial representation means what? We will just have let's say this is a box. This could be any system, okay? And as we have been talking about since some of our previous lectures, that this block will represent, when we will write on the paper, it will be represented in form of a mathematical equation also. So for example, if a system is a derivative or a differential calculating function, right? For example, if it is a differential amplifier. So in a very shorthand representation, it can be shown like this, and X is shown here as an input and Y is the output. So basically what this representation shows is that Y is the derivative of X. So Y basically is equal to d by dt of what? D by dt of the input X, right? So this is basically what it is. So we will have certain equation, and that can also be represented in form of a block diagram. Okay, there are some basic operations which can show, which we can show on the block diagram, right? One of the most basic operation is the addition and subtraction, means basically algebraic summation, we can say in general. Okay, and to represent that, it is quite simple. On the arrow, we show the name of the quantity. At the end of the arrow, when it comes to a summing junction or summing point, we show plus or minus sign. And that simply indicates whatever the algebraic operation we are going to perform on those physical quantities, on those different physical quantities. Okay. So here, X, we have shown plus sign, Y, we have shown plus sign, and Z, we have shown minus sign. So the output here, you can also note down the directions of the arrows, that the directions are also very important. Remember, if you draw the diagram, if you draw the block diagram, but you do not draw the arrows to it, then it becomes meaningless. Okay. Arrows also play an utmost important part in the system representation. So arrow, you have to pay attention to the arrow direction also. Okay. So here it is simply X plus Y minus Z. So that is what the resultant quantity is. Okay. Then there is also another thing called as takeoff point. Okay. what is takeoff point? You can see here, x is coming, x is the input here, and we are showing some branches of, going out of it. But these branches are not equivalent to the electrical branches. Note down this thing. Or in case of electrical circuit, if something is going out of a node, then the quantity gets divided into those three components, right? In electrical circuit, if this was a current, for example, X is a current, and you show three branches, then we will have to save X1, X2, X3, and addition of the three would have been equal to X, right? But this is not the case in case of this block diagram representation. What it shows is whatever the quantity is, it is the same available to us. So it is basically like a shorting. Shunting we are doing. We are shunting it. Okay. The direction of the arrow again is important. Okay. Sometimes we will see that the arrow goes forward, and sometimes we may see that the arrow is going backwards, but it doesn't really mean that the value is different. The value going out or going out from the takeoff point is same. Okay. Now, for example, consider this equation x3 is equal to a1 x1 plus a2 x2 minus 5. So in this case, x1, x2, x3 are variables, obviously, and a1, a2 are the general coefficients or mathematical operators. So if I want to represent this, if I want to represent this particular equation in form of a block diagram, then what I can do? I can do it like this. X1, as I said, x1, x2 and x3 are the variables. Means those will act as starting points or starting and ending, means terminal points of the system. Okay. So x1 is getting multiplied by a1, a constant. So x1 multiplied by a1. So now here again, you can see a new concept that if there is a block, right, this is a block inside a path, it simply multiplies, right? It was this path, right? X1 going here. So if this is a path and this block came inside, means a block comes into series, it simply multiplies the input. And the multiplication quantity goes to the output, right? Similarly, here also x2 multiplied by a2 is equal to a2 x2, right? And finally, we are adding these two quantities, right? Here also, obviously, there is no minus sign, means assume sign is positive, right? So here it is a plus, here it is a plus. So both being added, and 5 is getting subtracted, right? So here it is minus 5. So this is how we get x3 is equal to a1 x1, right? A1 x1 plus a2 x2 minus 5. All three quantities are getting algebraically summed up here. So plus sign for the first two, minus sign for 5. So that's what we will get. Okay. So this is how the block diagram can be an equation can be converted into a block diagram, and vice versa also. From block diagram also you can find out the equation. Okay. Now coming to a very important concept, and the diagram for this particular thing, which is called a canonical form of a feedback system, right? Please take notes of whatever you are seeing on the screen, because this is going to play a vital role throughout this particular subject. I'm not only talking about the first unit, but I'm talking about all the until end of the subject. Means even until the sixth unit, you will come across this diagram, and what we are going to perform on this diagram, you will have to perform even in the sixth unit also. Therefore, this is forming the most important concept in the block diagram representation form. Okay, so here some of the common conventional names are given to this in this block diagram are: this is the reference input, and C is the output of the system. Okay, जी इज द डायरेक्ट ट्रांसफर फंक्शन और ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज फॉरवर्ड ट्रांसफर फंक्शन. ओके देन एच, वेर इज दिस एच? हियर यू कैन सी इट हियर एच. सो एच इज कॉल्ड अ फीडबैक ट्रांसफर फंक्शन बिकॉज इट इज बेसिकली इन द पाथ ऑफ द फीडबैक. ओके एच इज द फीडबैक ट्रांसफर फंक्शन हियर. देन जी एच, दिस अनदर this is actually another quantity, just simply multiplication of G and H. Okay, GH is called open loop transfer function. Okay, or also called as loop transfer function. Note down the difference. Okay, loop transfer function and loop transfer function or open loop transfer function. This is the name given to it. And what we are going to find out afterwards at the end of today's lecture is the closed loop transfer function. Okay, so that is something different, and this loop transfer function is something different. Okay, so we are going to see both of those, right? Okay, then C by R, this is what I was talking about. C by R is called a control ratio or also called as control loop transfer function. Okay, so it is the transfer function of this whole loop. So basically it is just like writing this. Okay, here it is C, here it is R, and this is nothing but then C by R, right? So it is basically the overall or equivalent representation of the whole system. Okay, so this is what we are going to need in the end. This is what we are going to need in the end, C by R. Okay, right, C by R is what we are going to need in the end, and that is also called as closed loop transfer function. Okay, the formula for that is given here. You can also note down this. C by R is equal to G upon 1 plus minus GH. Okay. Now this plus minus means it can either be plus or minus. This depends on the value here, minus or plus. Okay. Take a close resemblance of the between the two. Note down this close resemblance. If this feedback is having negative sign, means it is called negative feedback. So if this is a negative feedback, right, if this is a negative feedback, then the sign here will be positive, and if it is a positive feedback, the sign here will be negative. Okay, so note down the correspondence. Here I have written plus minus plus, and here I have written plus minus, right? Okay, now the another ratio is E by R, means here E by R, which is called the actuating signal ratio or error ratio. Okay, this E, the quantity E, basically is the error between the reference input and the observed output. Okay, that is called the error. Okay, so actuating signal or the error ratio is E by R is equal to 1 upon 1 plus minus GH. Simply just there is a division by G to this. Okay, and then finally B by R is the primary feedback ratio B by R, which is equal to GH upon 1 plus GH. Okay, anyway, the most important thing to remember is this one, which is called the control ratio or closed loop transfer function, and the formula for that is G upon 1 plus minus GH. Okay, G upon 1 plus minus GH. This is the most important formula that you should remember. Okay, so that's why I have written it again here. The control ratio is the closed loop transfer function of the system, which is called as CS by RS is equal to GS upon 1 plus minus GSHS. Now note that sometimes in some books, you will find it written as GS. HS means it is a function of S, it is a function of G, function of S. All these quantities are functions of S. And this is obvious that because you have seen already that we are starting with the transfer function. We are talking about the transfer functions, and as known, transfer functions are basically the ratios of Laplace transform of output to the Laplace transform of inputs considering zero initial conditions all the time, right? So the best way of representation is like this: g of s upon 1 plus minus g of s h of s. However, in particular cases of block diagram reduction and signal flow graph, if in the problem they have just given it like this without mentioning that, without explicitly saying that these are the functions of s, then we can skip the function of s notation. Okay, but that is only in case of block diagram reduction and signal flow graphs. Okay, that too is dependent on how the question is asked. Okay, now the denominator polynomial of this particular function, of this closed loop transfer function, is called the characteristic equation of the system, right? So what is the denominator polynomial, denominator equation here? It is 1 plus minus gshs. Okay, so this 1 plus or minus gshs is called the characteristic equation of the system. Okay, now again, just I'm trying to relate these things with what we studied yesterday, cs by rs. What was that? What is that today? What I said, this is the closed loop transfer function. Okay, and the denominator of this, okay, see, this is what is called transfer function, right? So denominator of this particular equation, until yesterday what we were saying, we were representing it in form of a polynomial d of s, means the denominator polynomial, which is also a polynomial in s. And what we are talking about, roots of the denominator polynomial are called what? Roots of the denominator polynomial are called as what? Roots of the denominator polynomial are called as poles of the system. Now in this case, what we are saying, the denominator polynomial or the denominator of the closed loop transfer function determines the characteristic equation of the system, right? So if you combine these two things, the denominator polynomial is called the characteristic equation of the system. So roots of the characteristic equation are nothing but what? Roots of the characteristic equation are called as poles of the system. Okay, roots of this characteristic equation are called as poles of the system. So it is basically the same thing as saying that roots of the denominator polynomial or roots of the characteristic equation. Okay, so we have both of these things. Now just a simple example I have put in here. Here is a function g, here is a function h. Instead of h, I have written here 0.1 and c. So can you try to write down all these values of all the values of the functions that I have asked for? For example, open loop transfer function is gshs. So what is the value of gshs? Now take out your pen and paper, draw this diagram and try to solve or try to write down all these answers. Okay, I'll give you 5 minutes and you will share me your answers. Okay, you'll share your answers with me. For your convenience, I am giving you the formulae for each of these. Okay, so these are the formulae given. Okay, Okay, so start answering. Okay, so who has solved? How many of you have solved this? Preeti, answer of the first question. Preeti, Amruta, is it that difficult to find out the answers here? You have GS, you have HS. What you need to do here? You have to multiply GS and HS. This is GS, I have also shown in the diagram, and this is HS. So just multiplication of these two. Anyone? No one is solving this problem. Anyone interested in solving the problems? Anjali, you are not audible. Can you repeat?
Function is equal.
Okay, I hope you all will solve this, because if see, control system one subject is like this, it is a lot mathematical. If you don't write down in your own way, if you don't solve in your own way, you will never get the cusp of the subject. So it is obligatory for each and every one of you to solve this problem on your own. Okay, I have given all the formula here. You can you write down all these things and solve and post your answers on our group. Okay. Now coming to why we are doing this, why we are doing the block diagram representation, block diagram representation of the systems and these things. Why we are doing this? The basically. Block diagram of a practical control system is often quite complicated. why we need a reduction, okay? Because if you see, there are n number of components, and as you can see, if you can recall the definitions that we have we have put forward in the in our early lectures, a system is a interconnection of components for a specific purpose, and a control system. So basically, a control system itself is a system. So if there is any system, we can always represent that system in form of a transfer function. So each subsystem will also have its own transfer function, which will be limited obviously to that. Okay. So basically, even in the earlier example that I have shown, there are various smaller systems, and in that itself we have interconnection of those, and we are trying to find out the transfer function of a bigger system, right? So as you can guess now, and also I will show you in some example, that when we see a practical control system, there could be a lot and lot and lot of various components or various subsystems, and so those can be connected in different ways. There can be forward and feedback paths, and in that way the system becomes quite complicated to comprehend. So by means of systematic block diagram reduction, we can come to a very simplified representation. We can arrive at a simplified representation of the control system, of the whole system, and it can show us a single equation in form of in when the diagram is represented in a canonical form. Okay, so this is what we are going to do in the block diagram reduction techniques. Okay, to start with, there are multiple options, or basically there are multiple rules which will be employed for performing the block diagram reduction. Okay, and the first and foremost, which is very simple and logical based on the discussion that we had today, that when two blocks are in cascade, right, this is called cascading, right, one after the other, the overall or the resultant block is basically multiplication of the two blocks g1 g2. Okay, input, if this is the x and this is the y, it is the output is simply, again here it is x and y. So it is very quite logical. What will it be here? It will be g1x, right? Because this is what we have seen already, that the output here will be g1x, and what will be the output here? g2 into g1x, right? So this is what nothing. This is nothing but what I have written here. It is g1 g2 x, right? So this way we can also verify the output remains the same. Even if we combine two blocks into a single one, the output is equivalently correct. Okay, on a similar note, we can combine blocks in parallel, means if there are two paths going in the same direction, that is the most important thing, right? These are two paths, but both are going in the same direction and getting added here. So in that case, these two blocks become parallel. And if there are two blocks in parallel, we will just add them with each other. We will just add the two blocks with each other. Okay. Now here comes some of the complicated rules for block diagram reduction, and that's what we are seeing now. Moving a summing point after a block means if this is the original structure in the diagram, and for some reason what I want is I want this block to be after the block. So equivalently, we will need to make some equivalent changes to the representation. So again, here we can see, if this is, let's say, x, this is y, and let's say this is z. So what is the quantity here? X minus z. Am I right? Both arrows are coming in. This is summing junction. Here it is x minus z, and the output here is what? G into x minus z, right? Or it is also can be written as gx minus gz. Am I right? Is it clear? Just simple mathematics, you can see, right? It is quite intuitive also. You can, there is nothing fancy that we are doing right now, okay? So what ultimately we want, even if we change the structure of the diagram, what we want is the quantities should not get changed. Here we want the same quantity gx, okay? G of x into g into x minus gz. This is what we want, right? We don't want the actual output to change. So just we have to ensure that it remains the same. So what is this here? This is g of x. And what is this? This is g of z. And what we want, subtraction between them. So if I have the same thing, the path coming from x is positive, path coming from z is negative. So ultimately we are going to get the same quantity, right? You can also check and verify whether what I'm saying is correct or not. Okay. Okay, so this is what when we are moving a summing point after a block. Okay, here note down the summing point was before the block. Now the summing point is after the block. Okay, similarly, we may need some inverse operation. We may need to move a summing point before the block, right? So if we apply similar mathematics to this diagram also, we will get this kind of representation, right? Here it is x, here it is z, and here it is y. Ultimately the output here is g of x minus z. So this is what actually we must get here. This is x, this is z, and this is y. So if just take a closer look at this. If we are moving this summing point before, right? Means whatever the quantity here is, this z quantity, it will get multiplied by g, right? When we move this summing point before. So in order to avoid that, or in order to avoid the effect of multiplication, what we will need to do, we need to multiply by, or we need to divide by g. So what we are doing, we are dividing z by g, and then it will automatically get multiplied by g. So what we have here is z by g. Okay, here it is what? X minus z upon g, right? And if you multiply this whole thing by g, what we'll get? Gx minus z, right? Z upon g into g will be z only. So basically this output remains the same in this case, right? Any doubts until this point? Anyone has any doubts? If you have, just ask, okay? We can solve those. We can clarify again, okay? So, moving ahead, Similarly, we may need to move a takeoff point after or before a block, right? Before or after a block. So, for example, if it is like this, and we need to move it after the block, then you can see the quantity here. If it is x, then here also it is x, right? So if we move this point here, what is the quantity here? Here it is g of x. But what we want going out in this direction, we want x. So we will divide the resultant again, and that's what we are putting in the in its path 1.g. Okay, this is how we are going to address this issue. Similarly, moving a takeoff point before a block, if it is here and we want to move it here, so again the same thing, x gx. So what is going out is gx, but if we just move it before it, so here it will be again only x. That's why we will have to multiply it afterwards again by g. Okay, now coming to the most important one, we have to eliminate a feedback loop. We have to eliminate a feedback loop from the system representation, and for that we have to again remember what this particular diagram is. So can you recall from today's lecture, we have seen this diagram in the beginning. This is nothing but the canonical form representation of a feedback system. Okay, this is the canonical form representation. Here is R, here is E, and here is C. So what we want, instead of this whole diagram, we want only a single block representation. And therefore, what inside the block you are going to write is C by R. And the formula for C by R is what? G upon 1 minus plus GH. Here you can see again, I am showing you the correspondence here. Okay. If this is plus minus, then here has to be minus plus. All of you put your attendance in the chat box quickly. We are going out of time. Okay. All of you put your attendance in the chat box.